Dear learners, welcome to NIOS. This is Colonel Virendra Mohan. I shall be taking you through the lesson number 4 of military history, that is Maurya and Gupta armies. The objectives are to describe the Mauryan Empire and its army and to explain the organization of Gupta's army. You would have surely heard about the mighty Mauryas and Gupta dynasties. These kings were very powerful and were able to administer their huge empires. The earliest ruler of Magadha was Bimbisara in 544 BC, and thereafter, the rule and expansion of Magadha continued in small measures in the Nanda dynasty. Subsequently, in 321 BC, the Mauryan dynasty was established under Chandragupta Maurya. Mauryan Empire was the turning point of Indian history. Kautilya, known as Chanakya, wrote the famous treatise of Arthashastra. He gave the world a practical way of governance, including art of diplomacy, war strategy, law and commerce. The Mauryas maintained a large standing army. It was adequate for all its needs of controlling very large empire. The chariots, cavalry, elephants and infantry were the main composition of the force. They had the variety of chariots in all the 6 varieties were there. 3 types were used in the battlefield for actual fighting. 1 type was used only for training, 1 for marching towards the enemy, 2 types for general duties in the war zone. There were 3 varieties of chariots according to the number of wheels used, that is 2-wheeled, 4-wheeled and 8-wheeled. I must also tell you the types of troops during this dynasties. Kshatriyas, these were the troops of the hereditary warriors who formed the majority of the army. Mercenaries and freebooters, these were the hired individuals who were seeking military adventure, and they were temporary, need basis. The troops provided by local zamindars and businessmen. Then were the troops supplied by allies, deserters, etc. from the enemy. Then followed there too was the tribesmen from the wild forests and hills. Tactical organization of the Mauryan army can best be understood from this picture. The Mauryan army had 3 components: elephant component, horse component and infantry component. There were 3 archers and 1 mahout for each elephant, and for each horse there were 3 horse cavalrymen and 5 infantry soldiers. This unit was known as Patti, Senamukh or company. This 12-man unit, when assembled in 3 units, was termed as Senamukha or also known as a company. Gulma or battalion. 3 of Senamukhas or companies formed together and comprised of a Gulma, which is also known as a battalion. Aksohini or army. Units were added in multiples of 3, forming an Akshani or army comprising of 21,807 patties. The phrase combat arms was used, and it denoted cavalry or oblique chariots, oblique elephants combined with infantry soldiers either together or as a combination of 2 or more. Kalinga War. Ashoka was the greatest kings of Indian history. And this Kalinga War was fought between Mauryan Empire and Ashoka and the state of Kalinga. Kalinga was a feudal republic located on the coast of the present-day Indian state of Odisha and northern parts of Andhra Pradesh. The Kalinga War, the only major war Ashoka fought after his accession to the throne, is one of the major and bloodiest battles in ancient world history. The people of Kalinga Kingdom were known as Utkal, were the first of the Bharat natives who traveled offshore to southeast for trade. For that reason, Kalinga had some important ports and powerful navy. They used to follow open culture and uniform civil code. Let's see what were the reasons for Kalinga War. The main reasons for invading Kalinga were both political as well as economic. Kalinga was then said to be glorious and prosperous region consisting of freedom loving and artistically skilled people. Results of Kalinga War. War always results in death and destruction. This war resulted in the death of 2 lakh soldiers on both the armies and was a turning point in the life of Ashoka. Ashoka could not tolerate this bloody sight and he renounced the violence for his entire life on seeing the loss of so much of life and establishment. He decided to follow the peace and harmony path in his kingdom and guided the people to lead a prosperous life. Arthashastra, in the period of Mauryas, we also used to call the Mauryan period as the birth of Jainism and Buddhism as well as the birth of Arthashastra. The word Arthashastra means the science of acquiring wealth and protection of the earth. Earth also stood for material well-being such as wealth on which the propriety and prosperity of human being depended. Kautilya is said to have written the treatise of Arthashastra during the reign of Chandragupta Maurya. These treatises covered all subjects required by the king to rule over his kingdom. It commences with as to how the king should conduct himself and the subjects he should learn and the daily routine he should follow to be a good ruler. Also, it subjects the law, commerce, budget and accounts, foreign affairs as well as defense. For an efficient government and implementation of policies, Chanakya also gave a great detail of the administrative organization which is required for running a smooth and effective administration of an empire. What responsibilities were undertaken by the king? As per the Kautilya, the king had 3 responsibilities: protection of the people from external aggression, enlargement of territory by conquest, and welfare of the people. What kinds of wars were fought? During Kautilya's time, first was the Mantra Yuddha, that is war by council or the diplomatic war. Then was the Prakasha Yuddha, that is open warfare, that is a set piece battle. Then Kuta Yuddha, concealed war, a secret war or psychological war. Then followed there was the Guda Yuddha, which is said to be clandestine war. Clandestine war meant war by covert operations using agents, double agents, etc. Likewise, the Gupta Empire ruled between AD 300 to AD 550. Between the Mauryan dynasty and the Gupta period, the large empire was broken into smaller kingdoms under Kanishka, Satvahanas and the Kalingas rulers. The tactical organization of the Gupta army. The basic organization of the army and its employment in battle remained similar over the years. The military of the Gupta Empire remained based on traditional 4-part armies of Chaturangabla. They, unlike other armies, included a mounted cavalry by this time. They modeled the dress and armor of their cavalry after the well-crafted and equipped soldiers of the Kushan Empire. What weapons they used during the war? They used the lances or swords. Bow and arrow were made of metal instead of bamboo or wood, as in their times. The version of the long bow was composed of metal or more typically bamboo and fired a long bamboo cane arrow with a metal head. Iron shafts, they were used against armored elephants. Fire arrows were not part of the bowman's arsenal, contrary to popular belief. During the reign of Chandragupta II, Gupta Empire maintained a large army consisting of 5 lakh infantry, 50,000 cavalry, 20,000 charioteers and 10,000 elephants, along with a powerful navy with more than 1,200 ships. Chandragupta II controlled the whole of Indian subcontinent. The Gupta Empire was the most powerful empire in the world during his reign. The reason for conquest and building a large empire was to protect the kingdom from disintegrating into smaller ones, thus dissipating the power. The decline of Mauryan and Gupta period led to such a disintegration and weakening of the forces, thus invaders such as sultans were able to overcome the later kings and establish their control over India. So, dear learners, I have tried to take you through the Mauryan Guptan armies, their powers, their modus operandi, and the way they manage huge armies, and the necessity of having such an army, and the birth of Ashoka, and how Ashoka renounced the violence after seeing the bloodbath in Daya River next to the battlefield. I'm sure this will be a useful knowledge for you, and should you like to enrich your knowledge more and more, I would recommend you to go through the website of NIOS on the concerned subject and also the internet domain and beneficiary, so that you can further pass on your knowledge for the benefit of others. Thank you very much for your patient hearing and learning.